The reason why we started with Live Aid was because the shoot got pushed. We were meant to start shooting in July, and we started shooting in September. We were told if we didn't start shooting in September, there's absolutely no way we could film Live Aid in the UK any later than September, because obviously you can't pretend it's July the 15th or whatever when it's actually December the 12th, because in the UK it's going to be pretty bleak. So we had to get going, so we decided to, well, I didn't decide, but the production decided we're going to start with Live Aid. So we all showed up on set. Let's have a look here. I remember I arrived on set that day and was confronted with this, like lots of scaffolding, and this full-size replica of the Live Aid stage. And it's basically built on a runway. It's like, you know, if you, yeah, I'll show you some pictures. It's like a runway behind. So if you look at this here, it looks a bit like this. So that's a shot from on stage looking out down the runway. So you get the idea. So we had these 600 people, and I said to the production, one thing we have to do is record those 600 people without any of the PA playing, singing along to all of Live Aid. Otherwise, we'll never be able to create Wembley Stadium. So yeah, you can see them there. They don't actually look that many when you see them like that, do they? I think so. I thought it was going to be a lot bigger. And then when I actually saw them, I thought, but there must have been some people who didn't show up that day or something. They probably got down to about 500, because I think they always overestimate with extras, because there's always people who miss the bus and didn't feel well that morning and things like that. So you're always going to, you know, you get it less than you imagine. And then I realized, how on earth can you record 600 people and not have the sound of the music in that recording as well? Because we had a huge PA there, just like Live Aid, to play the music back through. But obviously if I played the music back to them so they could sing along with it, then I would end up like in One Direction, where you've just got more of the PA than the crowd. So I suddenly realized that the only way we could do it, because we can't give out 600 sets of headphones, that would be like a technical nightmare, and the time pressure on a day like this. You can see that they're actually recording. We were recording like the crane shots, the shots that come down into the crowd, the close-ups. So it was people dancing, singing, the kind of, you know, the, we wanted the real people for that, because a lot of the Live Aid is actually visual effects. We were under a great deal of time pressure. And they said to me, you know, that usual question, how long do you need? And I said, about an hour. And they said, that'd be ridiculous, you can have about 5 minutes. So I said, so I agreed with them. These what we call Manitous, as you can see on the side there, Manitou. Now, they use those because if you imagine filming from sort of 8 in the morning till 7 at night, the sun will start up over there and it'll move round. Now, if you want to go from one shot to the next shot and you want to cut those two shots together, if you've got shadows on one side of the face, then shadows on like that, you have to basically block out the sun. So that you don't have any shadows casting on anybody's faces, so we can shoot for 11 hours and not notice the time of day. Otherwise, you would never, in the editing room, you'd never be able to cut all those shots together, basically. So every time they move the Manitous, I said, well, what about when you move the Manitous, could I record them then? They said, yeah, no problem at all. So I managed to get them in 5 minute slots. What I did was I created these Pro Tools sessions that they look like barcode, and it would do it one line at a time, because I thought if I play them a line out the PA, they could then sing that line back to me. I had like a voice of God, so it's what they call it, the voice of God, which is the microphone for the PA. And I explained to them that they were going to hear a line coming out the PA, and I wanted them to sing back exactly the line that they'd just heard. Say in the case of like Radio Gaga, it'd be the PA would sort of go, all we hear is Radio Gaga, and then they would sing back, all we hear is Radio Gaga. Of course, some people always sang Radio Goo Goo, and had to remind them they're supposed to be singing back the line they've just heard. And we literally, with every single 5 minute break that I could get when they moved these Manitous, we went round and went through every single song of Live Aid and recorded that crowd. We managed to get about three times through all of Live Aid. It's an 18-minute set. So we did it three times through. And so we had essentially three Les, about 1,500 people. three layers of live, of them singing along with the songs. Another thing that I learned as well with the girls in One Direction was that they were all so enthusiastic that they learned the songs really well. Now, when we recorded them in the studio, it actually started to sound like a choir. And what we want for Live Aid is we want like a really unruly crowd that sounds like it. So everybody was complaining they didn't have the words, and I kept saying to them, if you don't know the words, you go, oh, we're here, radio, oh, just make them up exactly as if you'd had four cans of lager and you're at the concert enjoying it. You don't have to sing them perfectly, we want a crowd. So I was quite sort of, made sure that it was a crowd that we got. So we led them all up with sort of different, using different plugins. There's one plugin that I use, like to use called, I don't know if anybody's used, who uses Pro Tools, Avox Choir. And you can use that to kind of thicken up voices. If you've got like 10 voices, like if I recorded everybody here, then it would sort of, you know, it would basically make everybody here sound like about four or five times as many. So we used that. We used a thing called Altiverb with like a Wembley Stadium reverb, and we used delays, and we multiplied up these voices to kind of create Live Aid. There was a second key thing that we did with Live Aid as well, which was we went to a Queen concert and we recorded all of the music through their PA at concert levels with microphones all around using a sort of a similar setup to... that was at the concert. And then we use this here. So you can see this mic plan of what the mics that we had set out in the concert, that we could record, that we could kind of worldize, if you like, the sound of the concert. That's a whole subject in itself. So we go here. Make sure it's not too loud. So you can see, no longer a runway, the shot there. They were very expensive shots, they were. But they always say a concert, it's a three-way relationship. It's a relationship between the performer, the music, and the audience. Those three things are kind of key sort of things to make the concert what it is. We always knew that Live Aid, the story of Live Aid, was how it had actually plateaued. It reached a point where it wasn't actually going that well. And the story we wanted to tell of this was how Queen came out on stage and the audience were sort of subdued to start with, but then they grew and grew and grew with the band, which made you sort of feel, it gave that sort of emotion that people were on Freddie's side. So we really want to sort of tell that story. The only way we could do that would be to have all these different elements completely separate so that we could kind of adjust in a Dolby Atmos setting, so you've really kind of had the feeling that you are in the crowd. So the app, if you like, in Atmos or in the surround, we can actually put the crowd with the viewer of the film. So it feels like you're sitting in the crowd and the music comes from the screen. And then what we also had, because we did that world, what we call worldizing, we could put that into the roof of the cinema. So what you've got in these different elements, basically, obviously here we have the crowd. Let me have. We backed off there, so when it comes out of the tunnel. And then in the roof of the cinema, you would have this here, which is that kind of slap of the PA, if you like. So it makes it feel like you are at the concert. It makes it feel like you're back in the concert. You've got that element of it. Sounds like it's a real concert. So when you add the music in with it. And then you add the crowd in. So you put the. So by doing that, you can kind of create the feeling of being at a concert, because we now, instead of just having a multi-track of a live gig and trying to use that in the cinema, what we could actually do is we had these three distinct, completely separate elements. We had the music live as a multi-track, so it meant that when we move into Brian's guitar, we can turn the guitar up and down, so you get that feeling of movement. We had the crowd. We made the crowd in three different levels for the singing crowd. There was the big level that we recorded on the day. Then there was like a medium level. What we call a medium level, which we did at Shepperton Studios. They involved about sort of 25 people. Not quite as big as our other crowd on the shoot. It was an incredibly hot day that day. Everybody was really, really exhausted. But we got them to sing along, to sort of sing along. So we had the big crowd, you have the medium crowd, and then we went into an ADR studio, and what we did was we went through and sort of picked off, try and find a shot. Shot like that one there, say. Like that one there. Where you've got, is she going to do something? Where you have someone who's going to do. Basically, if there was a close up of someone screaming, like, then we would fill them with a voice, you know, double. So we'd have these three different layers. We had the big layer, we had the medium layer, and we had the individuals. The last thing that was really hard to get was the hand clap. That hand clap. We tried all sorts of things. We did it on the shoot. We got them to do hand claps, individual hand claps, but it never quite sounded as good as it sounds in the stadium. So Queen were on tour, so we asked Brian May if he could ask the audience to do us some hand claps, which he very kindly did. So I'll play some of that. He actually got at the O2 the audience to sing along. He actually said. So if you heard that, he said, if you do it well enough, you're going to be in the movie. And that's what got the cheer. Yeah, so you'll be in the film. And I actually wanted it for We Will Rock You, which was earlier in the film. So. That's the sound of a single hand clap from 20,000 people. So that meant we could snip out all of those individual hand claps and use them for Radio Gaga, use them for clapping along with Hammer to Fall, and we could reuse that material again and again throughout the whole concert. So we had our 500 people on set, we had our 20,002 people, and we had our individuals as well, hand clapping. So what we actually needed was the largest Pro Tool system, which is what was called a HDX3, that we could get to be able to play just the singing and the clapping for Live Aid. Because there were that many tracks, it wouldn't actually play on anything any smaller than that. It kept crashing with the computer. If we go to there, it gives us all our tracks of clapping and singing, and where else is it? There we go. There isn't enough. I can't play it on this. But it gives you the idea of what we ended up with for Live Aid. These three different, and then all these mixes as well, that make up the singing and clapping crowd. So we had to bounce some of it down to pre-mix, as they're called, to make it play. So that's basically how we created Live Aid. And it was, it had never sort of been done like that in the cinema before, where you'd actually been able to do a concert film and create the audience separately to the music, to the ambience that you hear as well, and to be able to mix it in Dolby Atmos to be able to kind of create that Live Aid experience. And also it even gave, you know, it gave us opportunity to be able to, if I can find a shot. There's one where we go to the back of the stadium.
That could really give the final push of the concert. So that just, we started with the crowd sort of low down, and then obviously by the end of the Live Aid reached its peak to kind of really tell the story about how he won over the audience. And actually it did, it gave Queen a huge revival in their career from that point. They then went to do a stadium tour of the world called the Magic Tour after this, just from this 118-minute set. Right, okay, I'm completely out of time. I realise that I've skipped a lot of things as well, but I should have moved a bit quicker in the beginning. But anyway, has anybody got any questions?